When I was a little kid, 6 years old, okay? I went to the grocery store with my parents, with my mom, actually. And when you're at a grocery store and you're at the checkout, there's always a whole bunch of something. What is that? Candy. And they put this there to torture parents, by the way, because every kid is like, fine. And then they get there and you're like, and so I was that kid and I was 6 years old and I remember there was a Hershey's bar. Okay, and I saw, and I know it's funny as I don't even like Hershey's, but there was a Hershey's bar, and I was like, I want it. And so I grabbed that Hershey's bar, I was like, Mom, can I have a Hershey's bar? Please, can I have a Hershey's bar? Can I have a Hershey's bar? And what'd she say? No, put it back. I was like, oh, but Mom, please. I begged and begged for this Hershey's bar. She says, no, put it back. And I was like, fine. And so she's sitting here putting all the stuff on the little belt thing, you know, and I go back over to it, and I'm like, and now my arm is stuck holding it like this, and I'm like, didn't do anything. And I'm 6 years old, and now, and all of a sudden, I am the most nervous I have ever been. And my heart is pounding. It's like, what if they saw me? What if somebody catches me? What if I'm gonna go to jail? You know, 6 years old. And so I'm going, and we get out, and like we're walking out of the store, and it's still here, right? And I'm like, oh my gosh, okay. I'm out of the store, and we're gonna get the bags out of the thing, you know, without moving your arm. And I hold it here the entire way home, a whole ride home. As soon as I get home, I run to my room, right? And I pull it out, and it's all like melty and stuff because it's been against my body. And I take it, and I go, and I have a dresser, you know, like with clothes, and I pull out the bottom drawer, and I stick it in there, and I close it, and I'm like, and I'm so nervous. And I'm thinking, what if my parents find out? Oh my gosh, I can't eat it when they're home. What if they find out? I'm going to be in so much trouble. And then, 6 years old, I go, God knows. And then I specifically remember this, okay? I was 6 years old in my room, and I'm like sitting right in front of my dresser like this. The drawer is closed because I'm too scared to open it because somebody might see this thing that I've stolen. And I'm thinking, I am going to hell. I am sure now that I am now going to hell because I have stolen this thing. I mean, for real, like I'm starting to cry, I'm starting to get upset. So I get the candy bar out and I go in to where my mom is and I said, Mom, I did something really bad and I have to tell you. And I told her I stole the candy bar and, you know, she went and, you know, told me how that's wrong and all this kind of stuff. But here was, though, at 6 years old, I thought that there was no way that God loved me anymore and could ever love me again because I had done something that bad. Now, I wish that was the worst thing I had ever done in my life, right? Is that when I was 6 years old, I stole a candy bar. Does anybody else feel that way? Like, I wish that was the worst thing I had ever done. Because as I got a little older, I started to do maybe some worse things, right? And some more bad things. In fact, as I got older, and I began to deal with some bigger issues, perhaps, than stealing a candy bar when you're six. I started to have some of the same thoughts that I did when I was a little kid sitting there on my room. Does God still love me? Is he mad at me? Am I going to hell now? And then I would have some certain things that I struggled with. Maybe you've encountered this where I would do something and then I would tell God I'm never doing it again. Until 2 days later when I did it again. And then I would say, I'm never doing this again. And I would do it again. And it wasn't like four times. It was like over and over and over again, right? And somewhere down like 100 times later, you're like, does he still keep forgiving me? Like, am I done now? Is he like, I gave up on you, hell for you, you know, a no more relationship. I mean, and I've gone through that and felt that at different times in my life. And maybe you have too, I don't know. Maybe you've kind of dealt with something that kept coming back and you wondered, can I ever actually stop? Or am I just gonna deal with this forever? Or maybe you've wondered, do I have a relationship with God? Does God love me or is he mad at me? So we're going to try to answer that, and we're going to look at a really unusual place that you might think. You might go, why are you reading that? What does this have to do with it? But you will see, okay? And it'll be, oh, okay? And so we're going to look in Exodus, and I would tell you what chapter, but here's the deal. It's kind of a long story, okay? If we were to read it, it's like eight chapters. So we're not going to read it because that's all we would do for the rest of the night, especially with how slow I read. We'd be here till like in the morning because I'm a super slow reader. But I'm just going to tell you a little about it. But if you were curious and you want to look at it later, it's in Exodus, and it starts in like chapter 8, and it goes, or actually chapter 7, and it goes all the way through to chapter 12. Okay, so it goes to there, and what's happening is this. There are some people, and they're called the Israelites. Maybe you've heard of them, okay? They were God's people in the Old Testament. They worshiped God, they served God, and God had promised them that they were going to be in a land, like, and serve him, okay? They were going to have a home, like a country, and serve him, but there was a problem. They were slaves. So the Israelites, or the Jews, they were slaves, and they had been slaves for 400 years. Now, like, they didn't live 400 years. They lived normal length lives like us. But, like, their people, for 400 years of people, had been slaves. Now, our country's only been around for 241 years, if that gives you some perspective. Because you think, whoa, that means it was really long. So there was, like, millions of them. They had always been slaves. Their grandparents were slaves. Their great-grandparents were slaves. They were slaves. They knew their kids were going to be slaves, so they were slaves. Now, you're thinking, this is God's people, right? Like, shouldn't they not be slaves? But they were. Then comes this guy named Moses. Maybe you've heard of him, right? Moses. And God talks to Moses and says, it's time for the people to be free, okay? And I want you to go and tell Pharaoh, that was like the king of Egypt, that to let my people go. Now, when I was in church, like children's church, we had like a song. Did anybody ever have stupid songs? Ours was Pharaoh, Pharaoh, oh baby, let my people go. No, no, no. Okay. Don't sing that again. Okay, yeah, it was stupid. But so he tells him, he says, Moses, you're going to go and you're going to tell Pharaoh, let the people go. And he's like, I don't want to do that. I'm scared of it. He didn't want to do it because he's not going to let him go. But he said yes, and back and forth, long story. Eventually he goes and he says, Pharaoh, let the people go. He's like, no. So then he goes back and talks to God, and God's like, okay, I want you to tell him that if he doesn't, I'm going to turn the river, the Nile, into blood. So the Nile is the river where they get all their water, and it runs through there. And sure enough, he goes, he tells Pharaoh, let him go. He touches the river, and it turns to blood. All the fish die, like the fish are dying and coming up because you can't breathe in blood, okay? And can you imagine? It had to stink, like nasty, okay? All the water turns in there, and he's like, now you let him go? He's like, no. And so then he goes on and gives all these plagues, and I'm not going to read all of them, but like this one. There was a plague of frogs. How many of you like frogs? Okay, listen to this. He said, let my people go. If you refuse to let them go, I will plague your whole country with frogs. The Nile will teem with frogs. They will come up into your palace and your bedroom and onto your bed. In other words, you're going to be sleeping at night and there's going to be frogs crawling on you, okay? Okay? Gross. Did somebody just touch you and freak you out? Yeah. But the worst one for me, how many of you have ever been sitting like at your desk or working and there's one of those little gnats, you know what I'm talking about? And you're like, get off of me, okay? And like it wants to like land on you and stuff. Okay, y'all know what I'm talking about, your experiences. There was a plague of gnats. There were literally millions and millions, like they were probably breathing them in their nose, okay? That was a plague. And then, so there's gnats everywhere and he's like, now will you let the people go? He's like, no, okay? And it keeps going and there's like, all these different things. There was one, a plague of locusts. Y'all know what those are, like those cricket things? Okay, now these weren't locusts, but when I was in eighth grade, okay, my mom drives me up to school, drops me up, well, actually before we even got out of the car, we're driving through the parking lot and I'm hearing this crunch. And I'm looking and the ground is black. It's normally like a regular, it was black. And I get out and the gym, we have a gym, like a basketball gym, the entire wall is black, except it's not normally black, it's normally tan. And I'm looking, I'm like, what happened? Oh, it's crickets. There were crickets that covered, they were going on the sidewalk with push brooms, shoving them off, and then someone was taking shovels and throwing them into trash cans like this. Just, they had those big, there were millions, it was disgusting. Okay, now they had that, but way worse with locusts, okay? And they were everywhere. They ate all of their plants, all of their stuff. Okay, it was awful. And yet he still wouldn't let him go. So finally this happens, okay? Moses goes to him and says, I'm going to see if I can get here. He says, let the people go, basically. And if you don't, at about midnight, the Lord says this, at about midnight I will go through Egypt. Every firstborn son in Egypt will die. From the firstborn of Pharaoh who sits on the throne to the firstborn of the slave girl who was at her handmill, and the firstborn of the cattle as well. Now, how many of you guys are the oldest boy in your family? Let me see. Woo! Let me see. Okay, you would be dead. All right. Just so you know, girls, if you have like a sibling, like a brother, and he's the oldest brother, in this case, he would be dead. And so he goes and he says, let him go, or this is going to happen. He says, I don't believe you, basically. I'm not going to do it. Well, the destroyer is going to go through all of Egypt. Well, the Israelites are in Egypt, and God doesn't want the Israelites to die too, right? And so Moses goes to the Israelites, and some of you may have heard this story, and he says, we're going to do something, and we're going to call it Passover. And they started like this thing. And so they took a lamb, and they had lamb chops, basically. They took a lamb, and they cooked the lamb to eat that night, and they took some of the blood, which is gross, but they took some of the blood, and they put it on the top of the door and some on the sides of the door, okay? So they put it on the door, and then he says, when the destroyer comes, and if he sees the blood on your door, he'll just pass over your house. But if it's not there, the firstborn in your house will die. Well, that night, of course, exactly what he said happened. All the firstborns in Egypt died except for the Israelites who put the blood on their doors. And Pharaoh's like, get out of here. I don't want y'all anymore. Get out of here. Finally, let them go. And from that time on, from then on, for like 1,200 years, the Israelites and the Jews, they would celebrate something they called Passover. So that once a year, they would have their Passover celebration. And this is what they would say. If you would say, why are y'all eating this meal? Why are you cooking this lamb now and doing all this stuff? They would say, oh, we're celebrating because we were set free from our bondage to Egypt, and we were saved from death by the blood of the lamb on our doors. They would all know that. They'd say, yeah, there was this time, and we were saved from Egypt. We were slaves, and now we're not. And that's why we're celebrating. They would say, everyone was going to die, but we didn't, because we were saved by the blood of the lamb on our doors. And so they celebrated this all the time. Now, what in the world does this have to do with us? Well, if you fast forward 1,200 years, there's Jesus. Okay, so Jesus is with his disciples, and we're going to look in Matthew chapter 26. Jesus is with his disciples, and they sit down to, you guessed it, eat the Passover. They're going to have a Passover celebration. They are getting together. They're going to celebrate these things 1,200 years later, okay? So here's Jesus. He's with his disciples, but there's something else. This is the night that Jesus is going to be arrested and crucified. It's the same night. So he sits down to do this Passover meal with them, and then he does something weird, okay? Jesus can do something weird if he wants to. And so he does something weird. It was what it seemed weird to them at the time. He does this. So they're celebrating the Passover. You guys know what that is now, okay? And it says, while they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body. So basically they're eating, and he takes some bread, and he starts to break it, and he takes probably pieces, and he's like, okay, here you go, Peter, and here you go, John, and he's starting to give them pieces of bread. And he says, this is my body. And I just kind of wonder if they're like, what does he mean? That's his body and he wants us to eat it. That sounds weird. In fact, another passage says, this is my body which is broken for you. He said more. He said, this is my body which is broken for you. And they're like, is he broken? I mean, did he trip coming in? What's going on? Did you see anything, Peter? No, I didn't see anything. Okay. And so they maybe, I don't know what they said, what they thought, but so he's passing it around and he's telling them to eat it. And then he keeps going and he says, and then he took the cup and gave thanks and offered it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. I want all of you to drink from it, he said. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. So I just kind of picture this, like he takes this cup and he goes, okay, I want y'all to drink from it. And so he passes it and John takes it and John's about to go and he goes, and this is my blood. What? It looks like, well, are you? It's not really, right? Because that's gross. And he's like, just drink it, okay. And so this is representing his blood, okay. Now, they probably did not understand what in the world he was talking about because he's sitting there alive. He hasn't gone to the cross. He hasn't shed any blood. He hasn't broken his body. Now, we understand, right? And this was the first time that disciples took communion, or the Lord's Supper, or whatever they call it. There's a whole bunch of different names for it. And many of you have taken communion. You've been in a church, and they passed out the little mini cup, little shot glasses of grape juice, right? And the little tiny, tiny cracker thing. And you've maybe found, or maybe you went to a church where everybody went down front and drank out of the same cup, or there's a bunch of different traditions. And so you've been in a church maybe where you've taken that before. Maybe you haven't. But Christians still today celebrate that meal. Now, I don't want to jump past this, though. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. The forgiveness of sins. And why is that important? Remember what we started talking about? Does God love me? Have I messed up too much? I don't want to just take for granted that everybody understands this, so I'm just going to say it like this. Let's look at this. It says this, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All have sinned. So in other words, all of us, okay, all of us have sinned. I have sinned, right? You have sinned. Your brother has sinned. Your sister, somebody like, you need to put more in there for them, okay? Your grandma has sinned. Grandma, for real? Okay, my wife, okay, has sinned. Just a little bit, okay? We all have sin in our lives. Every single one of us has dealt with that. We've all had sin. All of us. You know that. None of us are like, I have never sinned. I am perfect. If you are, man, you're messed up. Okay, you've really sinned in your pride. Okay, so all of us have sinned, he says. And then if he takes it another step and he explains something else to us, he says, for the wages of sin, the cost of sin is death. Let me say what that doesn't mean, like, I ate that stolen candy bar, so I'm dead. No, that's not what it means, okay? It means for the wages of sin is death. That means separation from God. That means you can't have a relationship with God. That means you can't be with him in heaven. That means you cannot have communion with him. You cannot be with him. You're separated from God. And there's nothing you can do about it. You're like, oh, well, that's bad news, okay? But, now I put it in blue because this is an important but. It's a big but, okay? It's a but that we all need to know, okay? For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. In other words, the gift of God is life. Life is this. Eternal life is this, to have a relationship with God. So some of you have seen this kind of an illustration before. So what happened was Jesus, his death on the cross, right? His death on the cross paid for our sin. So when we receive him and we believe that he died for us, he takes all of our sin, right? And wipes it away. Isn't that cool? I love that. All right. And suddenly it's clear. So your sin is no longer attached to you. It's forgiven. It says that it's wiped away or washed away. Now, so here's Jesus. He's having this supper with his disciples, and he said, this is my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. He says, my blood was shed. See, his death, that's the cost of my sin and your sin. His death pays for, cleans us of our sin. When we believe in him, believe that he's the Son of God, believe he died on the cross and rose from the dead. When you believe those things and you give your life to him, he washes your sin away. And so the question then is, does he love me still? Even though I've made mistakes, absolutely he loves you because you're clean. He's washed it away. He's made you clean. So now I'm going to connect something for you. And this is why the Bible is so amazing. And a lot of people don't even realize this stuff is in here. You remember what we said about Passover. If you asked a Jew, why are you celebrating Passover? This is what they would say. We were set free from our bondage to Egypt. We were saved from death by the blood of the Lamb on our doors. Remember that? Now, when we receive the Lord's Supper, when we take communion together, what is it that we're saying? We were set free from our bondage to sin. I used to couldn't help but sin. I couldn't do it. I couldn't stop. I just struggled over and over and over. But we're set free from that. You're no longer a slave to sin. We were set free from our bondage to sin. When we take the Lord's Supper, we're saying we were saved from death by the blood of the Lamb. That's why Jesus is called the Lamb of God. By the blood of the Lamb on the cross. And I added this, and given eternal life. Right? When we take the Lord's Supper, that's what that means. Now, the first time I took communion, I remember this too very clearly. I was in big church because I was a kid and I was usually in, you know, little church, I guess. And they passed out the little cup and they didn't have actual bread. They had the little cracker things, right? And do y'all know what I'm talking about, the little cracker things? Okay, yeah. They had them in these trays and they started coming out. And I was like, oh, snacks? I didn't know big church had snacks. And I was so excited. And then it came by and I was like, that's all? can I have a handful? I mean, they look good. And I chased it, and it wasn't really. But I didn't get it, right? It didn't really mean anything to me at the time. I didn't understand what I was doing. I definitely did not understand this, that that's what it represented for me. And then, you know, I got a little older, and it started to mean more. And what I want you to realize is when you take communion, that you can know that you're set free from your sin. Let me just tell you what that means. Because some of you are addicted to things. You feel like you can never get free of it. Listen, it says that you're not a slave to sin anymore. And so when you take communion, I want you to remember that. If you're struggling with an addiction and you just can't stop, this is what you need to tell yourself. I can stop because Jesus has paid this for me. And that's something to remember when you take it. When I was like 18, 19, 20, I was in college, like young college, and I was struggling, like a lot of guys do, with looking at stuff I shouldn't look at, right? I was struggling like a lot of guys do. I was struggling with pornography. And I would tell God, did the same thing a lot of guys do, and I say, and maybe some girls too, but I would say, I'm not going to do this anymore. I did it again. I'm not going to do this anymore. I did it again. I'm not going to do this anymore. I did it again. And I remember one Sunday, I was sitting in church, and they handed out the communion, and I knew what I had just done that week. And I felt like, can I even take this? Can I even eat this? Can I even, like, you know, does he even still love me? Because, I mean, I told him I wasn't going to, and I did it again. But what this should be for us is a reminder that he paid for it. That despite the fact that you've made mistakes and will still make more mistakes, he's forgiven us. That his blood was shed for the forgiveness of your sins. And when you take communion, that you can remember that it was shed for you. We all have things that we needed this blood to pay for. And he did. He paid for it. And I want you to know that. It's paid for. We're going to do something a little different tonight. We're going to receive communion together in just a moment. And I hope that you'll see it different than you have before. And before we do, I want us to just take a moment to reflect on ourselves. And so I'm just going to ask you, if you will, just why don't you just bow your head for a moment with me. And I just want to ask you to not distract anybody next to you for silly reasons. And before we do, I want to just ask this. If you have come tonight and you heard me talk about how that you can be forgiven of your sins by believing in Jesus, and you may think, I don't know that I'm forgiven. I don't know that I've believed. And you want to put your faith in Jesus tonight, you can. You don't have to continue with the weight of your mistakes and your sin, but you can let him forgive you. You do that by putting your faith in him. So I'm going to ask you, if that is you, to do something a little bit bold. In just a second, I'm going to ask you to just raise your hand so I'll know to pray for you. If you would say, I want Jesus to forgive me, I want to give my life to him, I want to be saved, why don't you just raise your hand so I can see it? You can put him down. There's a whole bunch of you. So can we just have everybody pray this with me? If you would not, I'm going to pray a prayer out loud and you're going to repeat it after me. We're all going to do it together. And if you believe this in your heart and you confess it with your mouth, then the Bible says you are saved, you are forgiven, you don't need to worry about your sin anymore. Y'all just say this after me. Father, I believe that Jesus died for me. I believe he paid for my sin. I know that I'm a sinner. I ask that you would forgive me. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice for me. I love you, and I give you my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that, you can look up. If you prayed that, I believe that your life will never be the same. So what we're going to do is we're going to receive communion, and you guys can go ahead and start. And I just want to say this, if as they distribute these things, if you'll just hold on to them, we'll take it all together in a moment. But if you're sitting there and you're like, okay, I'm not ready for that yet, that is okay, all right? When it comes to you, you can just pass it to the next person. No one's going to look at you and go, what's wrong with you? I mean, you can do it. But if you're a believer, I would encourage you to do that, okay? I would encourage you to hold on to it, and we'll receive together. And let's remember what he did for us. We're just going to, you can stay seated, but we're going to sing together. We're going to sing part of a song together. And they're going to distribute the emblems. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had broke it, he said to them, "This is my body, which is for you. Take this in remembrance of me." Let's just take the bread together. And before we take the cup, I just want to say this. If you feeling guilt and shame from your past, when you drink it, I want you to just say to yourself, "I'm forgiven," and know that you are. That he's not remembering it anymore. He's forgiven you. And if you're struggling with a sin and addiction that keeps coming back, to know I'm set free from that. I don't have to give in to that. And let yourself be free. It says, "In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" Let's take the cup together. Father, we just thank you that we can have this thing, this supper, this communion to remember all that you've done for us. And I pray that everyone here would know that they're loved by you, and that if they put their trust in you, that they're forgiven. In Jesus' name, amen.